morning, church.
Good morning.
That's a little better than that. Like I said, good morning, church.
Good morning.
This is the first Sunday after the Resurrection Sunday. I was saying in Sunday school, they have some people that go to church only three times a year. Mother's Day, Easter, and Christmas. But look, we need to be in church every Sunday. We need to have we don't have a Sabbath, but we need to have a rest day where we give God the honor and the praise for our life. Amen?
Amen.
Dr. John Jeter, Pastor North River Bible Baptist, glad to welcome you into our fellowship. Those who are watching by Facebook, by Zoom, those that are in our congregation, we want to say welcome to the house of prayer this morning. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Continuation in our teaching of Jesus Christ following his Father's will to the letter, to the T. See, if we're going to do the work of the Lord, we need to listen and follow his truth to the T. Amen?
Amen.
The truth is made more plain in two parables we're going to look at today. Two parables that Jesus taught. One of them is Matthew, called the parable of the two sons. That's the one we're going to really hone in on. The other one is the parable of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15. So we'll look at one of those today as we talk about it. God the Father is more pleasing with a repentant sinner who understands the grace and men that give up their will for the will of God. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus made that statement. Not my will, but what? Thine be done. So we're going to look at that today. Jesus said, I always do those things that please my Father.
Amen.
Amen? Amen? So grab your Bibles, your notebook, your phone, your tablet, whatever. We're going to look at three passages. You know the way I preach. We're going to do responsive reading. I give you my topic. I pray. And then we'll get into the Word of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
I believe, again, this is the inspired, inerrant, infallible Word of God. I believe in, again, the King James because I believe it's the closest translation from the Hebrew, the Greek, to the Aramaic. And I teach, thus said, this is what I call the written word. We have the living word. We have Jesus Christ as in the heaven, the Holy Spirit, making intercession for us. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 7. Put your finger there. And again, it's like I tell Jerry when we was in Bible college, the Bible institute, you need to lift your finger because we can walk through the Bible. Amen?
Amen.
Matthew chapter 7. Then we'll go to Matthew chapter 21, and then Proverbs chapter 26. So I give you time to get there because I believe that we need to stick with the Word of God. Let me just say, maybe 60-70% of the Bible is prophecy. A lot of things are happening in the world. Christ could come at any time. Now I believe in the imminent return of Christ. You look at what's going on in Russia, what's going on in Ukraine, what's going on in Iran, what's going on in Israel. So I just want you to stay with things. Don't get caught up in the politics, but you need to at least follow them because a lot of things are lining up with the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
We've been teaching on Wednesday about the Trinity. We've been teaching about, again, the veil being rent. So a lot of things is getting ready for Christ to come back. Matthew chapter 7. You there say amen?
Amen.
Matthew chapter 21. You there say amen?
Amen.
Proverbs chapter 26. You there say amen?
Amen.
So we'll start at Matthew 7. We'll read one verse together, verse 21. 1, 2, 3. Not everyone, y'all with me, hold on a minute, let's go back there. 1, 2, 3. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. And when we get into this, a lot of people talk about the Lord, but he said, no, just saying that is not enough. He said, but he that doeth, we're going to look at doing the will of my Father. That's what Jesus did. He's doing the will. And so even as Christians today, we need to be doing the will of the Father. Amen,
amen
somebody.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 21. You there say amen.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 21. We're going to jump down to verse 28. This is one of the parables that I talked about earlier. I'll read 28. You read 29 until we get down to 31. Matthew 21, 28 says, but what think you? This is in red, so Jesus is saying this. A certain man had two sons. And he came to the first and said, son, go work today in my vineyard. Verse 29.
Yes, I said, I will not. But afterward, you
went. So when we get there, we're going to see how a lot of times we start out saying we're not going to do it, but he changed his mind and did what the Father said. Mm-hmm. Now, this is the one we're going to preach on today, number 30. And he came to the second son, and said, likewise, go work. And he answered and said, I go, sir, and went not. Version. Go ahead, 31.
Well, the man twain did the will of his father. They say unto him, the first.
He said unto them,
verily I say to you, that the publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you.
So Jesus is talking to the religious crowd. Let me say I'm talking to the people that go to church that are not saved. Jesus is talking to, again, the goats in the church. He's talking to the people that come to church. He's talking about the people that are wolves in sheep clothing. He's saying, look, the publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom before you. Now jump down to verse 45. You there? Say amen. Read that with me. And when the chief priests and Pharisees had heard his parables, they perceived that he spake of them, verse 46.
But when they sought to lay hands on him, they feared the multitude because they took him for a prophet.
So when he would speak these parables, he would always condemn the Pharisees and condemn the Sepharites and condemn the religious people. And a lot of times when I preach sometimes, people get upset, but it's really not me preaching, it's the Holy Spirit of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Turn to Proverbs chapter 26, and again, give my last text, and then we'll give you a topic, and we'll pray and get into the Word of God. Proverbs 26, does that say amen?
Amen.
Verse 3. Proverbs chapter 26, verse 3. Read that 1, 2, 3. A whip for the horse, a bridle for the ass, and a rod for the fool. So this is what God says sometimes it takes for folks to get right. You have to go down to the bottom of the barrel. Sometimes I got to take a whip and like beat the horse, and you know, like a wild stallion, he need to be broken. Or I need to take a bridle and put on a donkey or a brachial or a rod for a fool's back. I added one more or two before for a mule. So some folks got a stubborn like a mule. So we're going to talk to you today about, here it is, are you like the first son who said no when he repented, or are you like the second son who said yes, but he didn't go? Would you bow your heads? Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for another Lord's day.
Yes, Lord.
A day that you have made, we'll rejoice and be glad.
Yes,
thank you for, again, the visitors. Thank you for our church people. Lord, thank you for the people watching by Facebook and by Zoom. Thank you for, again, the internet and for the technology that we have. There's people, even I heard some brothers when I was at the conference in Florida say, I watched Pastor Jeter on FaceTime, on live. So, Lord, thank you for those that are watching. We pray now, Lord, for, again, those that are sick, that are on the bed of affliction, that cannot be with us for whatever reason. Pray that you will go alongside and minister to them at this time, Lord. We pray for those that are maybe going to bereave. We just talked about Sandra Sarah, and then Monica lost a loved one. So we pray, Lord, that you would comfort those bereaved and help them to grieve whatever process they have and give them the grace to go on, Lord. Praying for, again, the corona situation, the variants that have been plaguing this whole world. Thank you for the first line responders, the nurses, the doctors, the firemen, the police, the pharmaceuticals, the ambulance drivers, the medics. Lord, just everybody to help them. Praying for those that may be still in the hospital on ventilators. Lord, maybe still in ICU, maybe still recovering from the corona. Praying that you would minister and work that situation out. Lord, we give you praises and honor for those that you have raised. I just thought about Taya, how she said her blood pressure came down. So, Lord, we thank you for all the things that you have done, Lord. Praying for our schools, Lord, our children on the last wave, Lord, last few weeks before they get out of school. Praying that they will learn. I heard so many times during corona that we got so far behind that our kids were not able to catch up when they were doing hybrid and virtual. So I'm praying, Lord, that we would get back to the level that we need, educational, that our kids will be able to make the grade and go to the next level and be able to take tests and do well, and ACT, SAT, and go on to college and all the things that you have. Praying for, again, like the summer that's be coming up, Lord, that you would give them activities, internship, or whatever they need to do. Praying that you work that situation. Thank you for our job. Thank you for our health. Thank you for our home. Thank you for our family, Lord, our kinfolks, Lord, our relatives, Lord, our kids, our grandchildren, our cousins, and everything. Now, Lord, I pray that you forgive me of my sins. Help me to rightly divide the word of truth. Pray for every church planted by your right hand. Let them down in the treasury of your word. Use me just for a little while to preach and teach the unadulterated word.
Right.
And we'll be careful to give you all the honor and the praise. For the name of Jesus, I pray. Let every heart say, amen.
Amen.
The most crucial, eternal question today to you and me is, are you doing to follow the will? See, there's a lot of people doing a lot of good things. There are a lot of people doing, but it's not the will of the Father. See, a lot of people say, I did this, but was that what God told you to do? Are you doing this for the Lord? So as we look at the Bible, we'll find out that Jesus Christ did his Father's will. The Bible is a mirror. It tells you how you need to be doing the things that please the Father. James talks about this. But be ye doers of the word, and not what? Hearers only. You know, I didn't ever understand that. Jesus would have all these crowds, and people would hear, but they would never do nothing. So that's indifference. That's apathy. If you're going to hear, then put your feet to the action to do some work. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Beholding your natural face is in a mirror. Most of you got up this morning, and you looked in the mirror. Well, the first thing you did was you had to wash your face, because you had all that junk in your face. Then you had to comb your hair, and then I know the ladies had to put on their lipstick, and you had to get it, but you had to dress up. So don't be like that when it comes to the Word of God. Look into the perfect Word of God. He convicts you, then you go right out and do. Don't do nothing for them. You need to do what thus said the Lord. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And as we look at that, James talked about don't be a forgetful hearer, but a doer. Don't be somebody that hear the Word of God and then go out and do nothing. And he started using three analogies in Proverbs, and I gave you one more. The horse that needs a whip. The horse is just a wild stallion. It's a picture of us. And we're just running wild, doing what we want to do. So you have to take a whip to bring it into shape. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Or a donkey. You know, we live in the state where we have wild donkeys. We have wild donkeys running wild. I was listening to old Faithful where they have a cocaine hippopotamus down in Mexico. They got all kinds of stuff. They got wild bulls that are in Alabama running, eating up all the crop. Let me tell you, those have to be brought under submission. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And then they sell food. Now, again, I don't want to tell you what food is. You shouldn't call anybody food. But the Bible said the fool said in his heart, there is no God.
Lord Jesus.
Amen?
Amen.
Now, I can't explain it to you, but the only reason he's able to say that is because God gave him the breath to breathe this morning.
Amen.
God woke him up this morning. People say, I don't believe in a God. Well, let me tell you, if God stopped the air, you couldn't be alive.
Amen.
So the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. But I'm here to tell you, even the atheist prayer, which don't make sense, is, if there is a God, I don't believe in God. Well, you just acknowledge there was a God. If there is a God, I don't believe in it. Well, why'd you say there's a God? So somebody told me this a long time ago, and Jerry can identify with you. There are no atheists, because when you go to the military, you get in the foxhole, everybody cry out, help you Jesus, help you Jesus. Everybody, you might not be saved, you might be hard and doing all that, but when you get in dire need, when you get on your sick bed, when you need some help, then call on Jesus. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You say, well, I don't know that tradition, I don't care what it is. People know that there is a God, maybe they haven't received him, but they need to call on somebody in the time of need. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Luke 12:47, and a servant who knew the Lord's will and prepared not himself, neither did according to the Lord, shall be beaten with many stripes. It's talking about losing reward. So the Bible says, when much is given, what? Much is required. Those of you all that sit under sound biblical teaching, you all have no excuse. You can go out and do what God tells you to do. Now the sad part is a lot of people sitting under false teaching, and they don't know no better. But eventually the Holy Spirit will get a hold of their heart and get them under some sound teaching that they will come from among all that crookedness that's going on. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Unrepentance is not doing the will of the Father. It's doing your own thing. You know, it's not almost like you put your finger in the face of God and say, you can't tell me what to do. Put your fist up in God and say, I do what I want to do. Let me tell you, God created you and you ought to adhere to what he says. Amen, somebody. Repentance is a change of heart. It's turning around. It's turning directions. It's going one way and doing a vow of faith like doing the military and going another way. It's making 180 degrees. Let me tell you, when a person comes to Christ, they turn from their sins and turn to a living God. Amen, somebody. If you went back in your life, there was a time in your life when you didn't know God. Huh? And don't tell me you've been saved all your life, but nobody been saved all their life. But there was a time in your life where you were doing your own thing, and the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, convicted you, and you turned from your sin unto the living God. Amen?
Amen.
I think that's what Thessalonians did. They turned to the living God. 3 points I want to give you this morning as we talked about. Which son are you? Are you the first son who said, I'm not going? But he repented and went. like the second son. He said, I'll go. And then as soon as daddy left, you ain't do nothing. Point number one, the first son is like the prodigal son or daughter who had a rebellious, a sowing wild oats type spirit at first. You know how it is. I want to do what I want to do. I get saved, preacher, but I'm young. I got some things I want to do. I was knocking on the door one time. I asked a young lady, I said, do you know the Lord? She said, well, I can tell you that you can receive him as your Lord and Savior. I said, are you willing to ask the Lord to forgive your sins and come in your heart and save you? The first word out of her mouth said, do that mean I need to give up my boyfriend?
No.
I said, you're not thinking about the Lord. You're thinking about what you want to do. And really not about, a lot of people get off in the do's and don'ts. It's not about smoking or drinking. It's about, first of all, being saved.
Amen.
When you fish, you don't clean the fish before you catch them. Amen. You just catch the fish and then you clean them. So it's not about your boyfriend. It's not about what you do. It's what you, first of all, acknowledge that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior.
Amen.
And once you do that, and by the way, I can just preach a little bit on myself. Once you do that, the Holy Spirit will start cleaning. You won't have to stop. You'll go home, you'll say, you know what, all that liquor I got, I need to pour down the sink.
Yeah.
Amen, somebody. You go home and say, you know what, all that stuff that I've been doing, the Holy Spirit will say, no, you know you can't do that no more. You know you can't go there no more. You know you can't hang with that person no more. You know you can't do that. Oh, y'all know what I'm talking about. See, I got saved during the time when they didn't have cell phones. You know, when they didn't have cell phones. So you had these little black books, you know, where you put people up and you hide them. And the Holy Spirit said, you ain't throw that in the trash.
Amen.
So you ain't throw that in the trash. Y'all want me to preach a little bit? See, the Holy Spirit will convict you. You ain't got to worry about what your friends say. The Holy, you ain't got to worry. You need to stop doing it. No, the Holy Spirit will tell you what you're doing is wrong.
Amen.
If you're going to live for me, you need to get it out of your life.
Amen.
You need to stop. And by the way, you know, I heard some people say, you know, I want a big cusser, but every now and then I say a cuss word. Let me tell you, the Holy Spirit will clean up your mouth.
Amen,
amen, somebody. Then what can be is sometimes you mess up.
That's good teaching.
And the Holy Spirit begin to work on you. Mm-hmm. And you begin to be like Peter. You don't really cry. Lord, I didn't mean to do that. I'm sorry. Lord, forgive me. And the Lord will tell you, you're a work in progress. I'm still working on you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
This first son is like, again, the wayward son or daughter. They have a rebellious spirit. Like the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel was always doing wrong. They was always doing things that didn't please the Lord. They was in idolatry, they was in rebellion. And God likened them into a wild donkey. I told you about a wild donkey, how they had to be broken, and how it couldn't be turned, it couldn't break their will. So God is saying today, we need to stop being our own self. It's like the first son, the father said, will you go and do my will? He said, I will not. He just was bold. It's just like a child telling a parent, I'm not going to do it. You need to wash the dishes. I'm not going to do it. You need to clean the house. I'm not going to do it. He was just so straight up, I'm not going to do it. But later on, he repented. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
It's just like us today, you know. The Lord said, I need you to stop partying. No, I like partying. I can't quit, Lord. No, you need to stop. I need you to stop clubbing. I need you to stop drinking. I know drinking ain't got nothing to do with you being saved, but when the Lord work on you, he's telling you you need to stop. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
I need you to stop smoking. I need you to stop fighting. Oh, y'all know what I'm talking about. The first son said, I will not. I like what I'm doing. I don't want to do what you want me to do, Father. I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. And let me help you out. That's a picture of you and me. God is saying, I need to break your spirit. I need to get you to give up all that mess you got. And you be saying, no, no, no. But eventually, God broke him.
Amen.
And he said, okay, Lord. You're the one. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Think about old Jacob.
Yes, sir.
The supplanter. The deceiver. The trickster. The manipulator. He was all those things. First of all, he tricked his brother out of his birthright. Y'all know the story. His brother came in from work one day, told him, you made some soup. Oh, that soup smells. You know how when the aroma hit the house and they come in and smell that food. And he'd been out there hunting. And he some of that soup? Jacob said, oh, man. Sam and your wife, right? See, he was a crooked. He was crooked. His brother sold him the birthright. Now, Esau shouldn't have sold it because that was a picture of him denying his birthright. And then he allowed his, you know, this ain't even my message. This may be a Mother's Day message.
No.
He hooked up with his mother who favored the child. By the way, that favoritism was a problem in a family. Amen, somebody. And she said, I heard your daddy say he gonna bless Esau because he hairy and he's a hunter. But I like you, and we gonna trick your daddy, and we gonna put on Esau clothes, and we gonna put some hair on you, and you gonna go in and lie and say you Esau and get the blessing. He was a trickster.
Amen.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Manipulator. Then he gonna go down to 11. Go down to, you know, his mama, brother, house. And they ain't gonna try to trick him out of his cattle. Oh, I ain't got time. That ain't even my message. He gonna start putting those polished seeds down there, and all the cattle came up with rings strong and spots on me. He took all the man cattle. Y'all remember that? Tricked him. But then came the day, and he had to go back home. And he thought about that old brother. He saw gonna kill him. And the Bible said he started pushing the people ahead of him. And the Bible said at night, he wrestled with a man all night. Y'all know the story. That was God breaking his will.
Amen.
He said, Jacob, I'm going to have to break you. You just like that first son. You don't want to go to the field. You don't want to do right. And sometimes God had to break your will and my will. And he had to wrestle with him and wrestle. And then he finally pushed his gift out of the sword. And he couldn't walk. And Jacob couldn't do nothing. And see, when you're helpless, sometimes you have to hold on to the Lord. Oh, let me preach a little bit. So you got to hold on to the Lord. And so the angel was in the lead, but that was the Lord Jesus. And he's in the lead. And Jacob said, you can't leave because I can't walk. You can't leave until you bless me. Oh, I know I've been crooked, and I know I've been a deceiver, and I know I've been a manipulator, but you're going to have to bless me. And the angel said, because you held on, hold on to God, I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to change your name to Jacob, to Israel, and you prevail with God. Let me tell you, he was like the first son. He repented, and God blessed him. Amen. I ain't got time to preach on my life, but I can tell you. And I was in the fraternity. I was at TVA. I was selling myself. I was doing everything. I had a nice home, had a wife. But God had to break me and break my spirit. When he broke me, I said, yes, Lord, I'll go. Amen, amen, somebody.
Amen.
Just like that first song. I knew the Father's will. Did I need you to go to the Bible college? I'll go. Did I need you to go to I'll go. Did I need you to go start knocking on doors? I'll go. I remember I met Jerry. Jerry Cullen had just died. I knew his wife. And Jerry had just got saved. And I said, Jerry, you need to come to Bible
school.
And Jerry said, yes, Lord. He went on the Bible. Amen. So I'll tell you what God break your spirit. Oh, let me preach a little bit. You know what you used to do, right? And you know what? Let me tell you. It wasn't normal for me or Jerry to go to Bible college. That was abnormal. It wasn't normal for me to start loving my wife and bringing my check over. That wasn't normal for me. It was normal to go out on Friday and party. Y'all know what I'm talking about. It was normal to go here to the happy hour or to the late. Now, let me tell you. Y'all know that. You know, I ain't been saved all my life. But let me tell you, when God breaks the spirit, you'll say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. What old first son said, I'm not going. But he said, yes, Lord. I'll go. I'll go do the Father's will. Like I said, that wasn't the end of the story. The man repented. Jacob repented. And he went to do the work of the Lord. How'd you like the prodigal son, y'all? Well, the prodigal son had that old haughty attitude. He went to his daddy. Let me just, you know, I'm talking about sons, but let me just flip a little bit. Sometimes girls just as bad. Sons and daughters are just as bad. And so went to his daddy and said, give me my money. I'll go out and live the way I want to live. I ain't got to live the way you tell me to live. And the Bible said that the young son, let me preach a little bit, went out and had a riotous life. Oh, y'all ready to preach a little bit? Went out and partied. Oh, by the way, let me help you out. When you party, you got a lot of friends. When you got money, you know, you buying everybody liquor. You buying everybody. You got a lot of friends. But the Bible said he spent all he had. Oh, y'all want me to preach a little bit?
That's all right.
I don't know where it's like this, but when you don't have any money, you me preach a little bit?
That's all right.
Sometime.
No, great.
God got to take you to the gutter to get your attention. See, after he had all that money and was doing all he had and thought he had together, then he didn't have none, then he had no friend, then he in the hog pen.
Hog pen.
Let me preach a little bit. Feeding hog. And then he got so hungry, he started to reach for the hog. Look at the hog. You know, y'all me preach a little bit? Eating pig food. He said, well, maybe he ain't going to eat that. Oh, y'all me preach a little bit? And sometimes, I just preach on myself. And y'all don't take this the wrong way. I used to be a bus boy, you know, like at Red Lock, a bus entertainer. And every now and then, you know, I was, like Gary said, we ain't having it. We wasn't poor, we poor. And every now and then I go and bust a table and somebody would have a plate they didn't even touch the food. You know, that big old piece of corn there, and a big old piece of, I figured that, vodka. And I would, you know, put it on top of it. You know, when I bust a table, put it on top of the bucket. Chomping down on that food.
Amen.
See, sometimes you got to eat. But what happened was, the younger son said, my father, hired servants eat better than this. I had it all right in my father's house. He just had some rules that I didn't want to abide by. But he came to himself. This is repentance, y'all. He said, I will go to my father's house and tell my father I've sinned against God. I'm not even worthy to be called your son. No. Just hire me as one of your hired servants. That's repentance. See, he was saying, I'm not even going to try to be a son. I'm not even trying to get anything. I'm just going to go and let him hire me, you know, like a maid, or hire me like a giant. I'm just letting him hire me because I need to eat better. But let me help you out here. This ain't even my message. But the father had been looking for a son. Oh, man, there's no way God looking for you. When you're outside of the will of God, you ain't doing right. He's looking for you every day. And the Bible said, when he saw him coming down, I don't know how, you know, you know your son walking, and you know your son from a distance. It could have been, I don't know, it could have been two or three blocks, but he saw his son coming, and the dad began to rejoice. Amen, somebody. He got happy, and he said, oh, my son, he came home, and his son came down, and the dad didn't even have time. He ran and hugged him with all that slop, and he hugged him, and he said, he said, Daddy, I'll say it. He said, no, you ain't got to say no more. You ain't got to say no more. He said, kill the fatted calf. Put a robe on his shoulder.
Yeah.
Put a ring on it. Put some shoes on his feet. Go, my son, alone, and not say it. Amen, somebody.
Amen. Amen.
That's like, that's just like that first son. That first son said, I ain't going. I'm going to do my own thing. But he repented. No reason to get the door for me. He repented and did and went and done the father's. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Point number two. The first son, like the prodigal son, had a rebellious attitude. Sowing wild seeds. He wouldn't do the father's will. The second son, now this is the one that got me. He looked his dad in the face and said, yes, I'll go. And as soon as his daddy got out of the room, he did not go. Amen. The second son, maybe like you and me, initially, we say yes, but deep down in our heart, we want to do our own will. Amen, somebody. See, you're going to have to break your will. I don't know if it's going to take a whip like you do the horse. Going to take a bridle like you did for the donkey. Going to take, again, a rod like you did the fool, or two before for a mule. You're going to have to break your back. Stubborn, rebellious. God has to break our back. We're sinners. We're rebellious to the things of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Righteous. He said, I'm going, but he's not. It's a form of godliness. Paul said the nation of Israel had a form of godliness, but not according to righteousness. You know, there's some people, they look good in church, but they don't live for the Lord. There's some people, you know, they look good on the outside. They put on their suit. They put on their dress. They come to the house of God. But they are not in the will of God. They're not doing God's will. They're living their own life. They're doing what they want to do. They're pleasing themselves. They're not pleasing God. God is not pleased with that. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
2 Timothy 2:19 said, everyone that named the name of Christ depart from iniquity. In a great house, in a church, there's vessels of good honor and vessels of dishonor. If a man or woman will purge himself, he can be used for the master. them from the sea. You know, the devil is very, very clever. He's like a serpent in the world. He beguiles me. The only example I give you is real simple time you can get it. When you want to catch a rat in the house, you put a little cheese. Oh, let me preach a little bit on the track. Oh, y'all ready to preach a little bit? And the rat is you. Okay? And so the devil say, I'm gonna get in the sniff on that cheese. That's you now. You sniff on the cheese. And then you go, oh, that's some cheese. Oh, that's some cheese. As soon as you stick your neck in there, boom, the devil got you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Oh, the devil slip. And you take that little carrot out there. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Hang that little carrot. I want you to come on and get it. Come on and get it. Oh, y'all want me to break it down to you? Let me break it to you. 2023. The devil ain't coming to you in no red jumpsuit and no pitchfork and no ears. He's gonna come to you with somebody fine, that, somebody look good, somebody got a good job, and somebody doing well. That's the devil right there.
Amen.
He's setting you up.
Amen.
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 You say the devil see nobody ugly. No, he gonna send you somebody beautiful. Miss America. He gonna send you somebody, Mr. Hump. You need to be careful.
That's all right.
Because the devil is out to trick you.
Amen.
He's out to con you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Not my will, but thine be done. Here's the other second son, the rich young ruler. Now you thought he had together because he was rich. You said, oh, I had the money, I'd be together. But he came to Jesus and he did have a question. He was really concerned about his soul. He said, Master, what must I do to inherit life eternal? I mean, he was really, he had a good question. And Jesus said, thou know the commandments. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and mind and soul and strength. And love thy neighbor as thyself. And he was like this self-righteous son number two. He said, I've done all that from my youth up. I've obeyed my parents. I did all that. But he had that one little stickler on him. He loved money. Coveted. The Bible said, thou shalt not covet. And Jesus was, now again, I want you to get this clear. Jesus wasn't asking him to just give it. He was saying, what are you doing? He said, I tell you what, you lack one thing. You self-righteous. You think you're saved. You think you're on your way to heaven. You think because you go to church, because you dress nice. You think go and sell everything that you have and give it to the poor and come and follow me. See, Jesus was testing his heart. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
The Bible said, and I'm going to put it to you in Jesus' theology. Give up my Rolls Royce. Give up my mansion. Give up my fine clothes. My sumptuous living. I'm a member of the Waters Club.
Right.
You mean to give all that up? You know, I'm a member of the fraternity. My name is on the top of the list. I'll tell you, turn around and walk away. See, what he was saying was, I'm not going to do it.
That's all right.
That was the second song said, I'm not going to do it.
That's all right.
Self-righteous. Self-righteous. Let me help you out. To come to Christ, you got to give it all up.
Yes, you do.
See, he calls for 100%, not 99.5%. You got to give it all up. When you come to the cross, the ground of the cross is level. So you have to give up everything, all that stuff you've been holding in your mind. Well, what about this? Give it up. Well, what about this? Give it up. Just come to the Lord. I'll never forget in 1986 when I came down the aisle and I was thinking about, I told y'all about opening up a jazz club and I was thinking about making all the money and doing it. And the Lord said, give it up. Come to me.
That's all right.
I came down on my face and said, Lord, would you save a wretched project boy like me?
That's all right.
Oh, God. So it like the Bible said, the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner that repent and over 99 just me. The angels were rejoicing when I came and asked the Lord to save my wretched soul.
Amen.
And give all that stuff up. My name on the signboard. My name on this board. My name on the next project manager, on the next senior EO. My name, I give all that up. My name on this fraternity. My name on this organization. I give all that up. God said, give it up. And come to the Lord. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Second son was proud. your lifestyle, them that are enemies of the cross. He refused to submit to the Father's will. He's a hell-bound sinner. He like the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the elders and the leaders. He refused to do the God's will. Let me tell you, going to church won't save you. Being a priest won't save you. Being in hell, you need to be born again. Jesus had to come down on the Pharisees. He said, you walk around in big, long robes and carry them long phylactery and act like you hold it. He said, you're full of dead men. Bones. Amen. God had to break them down. Let me give you my last point. We're close.
That's all right. That's great teaching.
Point number one. My title is, are you like the first son who repented? He said, no first, but he repented. Are you like the second son who said, yes, Lord, but he didn't go? Point number one, the first son, like the prodigal son or prodigal daughter, was rebellious, sowing wild oats, but he repented and got right with the Lord.
Amen.
The second son said yes initially, but deep down in his heart, he was rebellious and he wanted to do his own will.
Amen.
And he's a hell-bound son.
Amen.
And then our last point, right after Easter, the third son, which is not in our parable, I just added him, is Jesus. Voluntarily, independently, willingly surrendered to the Father's will. Jesus said, let this cup pass from me, yet not I.
Yes,
I will, but thy will be done.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus said, my dad, I know you can remove this cup. I know you got all power.
Yes, all
but
right.
What you will, I'm going to do.
Yes.
Jesus said, remove this cup from me, but not my will, but thy will be done. I always do those things that please the Father. I know I got to be beat with a cat of nine tails. I know I got to be spit on. I know I got to be buffered. I know they're going to put a crown on my head and go bleed. I know I'm going to have to die, but I'm going to do what God told me to do because that's the Father's will.
Amen.
Amen. Thy will be done. I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him. He always said it. I'll never forget. He said, the woman at the well. And the disciples went in to buy food. And Jesus talked to the woman at the well. He led her to the Lord. When the disciples came back, he was all happy. They said, anybody gave you something to eat? Jesus said, hold on a minute. My meat is due to the will of him that sent me. See, sometimes food won't satisfy like the gospel. Amen.
Amen.
Sometimes you have to bypass. Sometimes you have to fast. Sometimes I can't even get an appetite. My wife said, what you want to eat? I said, right now I can't eat. I don't have an appetite because I'm thinking about people's souls. I'm thinking about the kingdom of God. I want to please God. I want to do those things to bring honor and glory to God. Jared didn't know what he was talking about, my message. Yeah, we want to do things for the Lord. I said, Jared, let's get the landscaping done. Let's do it. I didn't know Jared went all the way to Atlanta. Well, I've been riding all over town trying to get a drill, but God worked it out. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We need to do God's will.
Do it.
I want to tell you, ladies and people that y'all have been doing for the church, keep doing what you're doing because it's the will of God.
Amen.
And by the way, the Bible says, whatever you do for the Lord, if you give a glass of cold water in the name of Jesus, you won't lose your reward.
Amen.
So don't get what you're doing for the pastor. Just do it for the Lord. He's going to bless you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Job said, I exchange treasure the word of thy mouth more than my necessary food. Job said, I would rather have a word than to have food. The psalmist said, teach me to do thy will, O Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Make me. We used to sing that song when it says, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me.
Oh,
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Then it said, make me, mold me, break me.
Yes.
Let me tell you, sometimes God had to break you and get you to do his will. The Bible said God will not despise a broken and a contrite spirit. See, you got to be broken. Some of us, we bold and we very challenging and we very argumentative and we very combative. God had to break your spirit.
That's all right.
For you to do his will. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Romans 9:16 said, it does not depend on man who wills, but on the Lord who gives mercy. See, the first son, he received God's mercy and he repented. The second son, he rejected God's mercy and he would not. But Jesus Christ, the Bible says like this in John 1:17, but grace, it said, but the law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by who? Jesus Christ.
Right.
You ought to be glad. Jesus always do those things to please the Father.
Amen.
You need to find yourself doing the Father's will. You need to find yourself lining up. Here's the acid test. Here's the litmus test. I'm a Christian, but you ain't got no fruit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a Christian,
That's right. But
your life don't line up.
Oh, Lord Jesus.
I'm a Christian. Hold on a minute.
That's all right.
If you're a Christian, then your light will be shining.
Amen.
First of all, he shouldn't have been in Sodom because that was a homosexual place.
Yeah.
But then he gonna try to go out and witness to his sons in law. Y'all know the story. But his life was so ragged that they laughed at him.
That's all right.
Y'all need to get up out of Sodom, God, on this show.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord.
You got to tell me something. You can't tell me nothing. Mm-hmm. Your life's so ragged, how in the world gonna see it? By the way, people will read you before they read the Bible.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. The Bible says you live in the epistle, knowing and read about one.
Right.
So don't be trying to tell nobody about the Lord if your life ain't lining up.
Because
so they're going to read to
yeah.
Amen, somebody.
That is true.
Preacher told me one time, a guy, I know y'all might know what he said, but I said it. I had a big hickey on his neck. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Ain't no trying to tell somebody about the Lord. And the guy said, how you going to talk about the Lord if you ain't even married? You got that big hickey on your neck. You can't tell nobody about the Lord. Amen, somebody. Oh, my God. Your life will be read by people before they read the Bible. You need to be like the first son. Yes, you was a wild stallion. Yes, you was a wild donkey. But God broke you. And God broke Jacob. And if God broke Jacob, he can break you. And if he break you, you will line up and say, not my will, but thine be done. First Thessalonians says, despise not preaching. Don't get upset with the preacher. I'm just a mailman. I just preach what thus said the Lord. People so many times say, well, you ought not preach that. Let me tell you, I didn't write the book. I just preached the book.
Amen.
You don't go, when the mailman drop off that big bill from you, or the IRS, you got to pay them, you don't go and choke the mailman so you can't choke me because I'm preaching what the word of God said.
Amen.
I don't know. Jerry said sometimes he's a mailman and sick the dogs on. Anyway, we need to preach the word of God.
Amen.
The Bible says, resist not the Holy Spirit. God will give you repentance. This last man, as I close, Stephen. The Bible says Stephen was so full of the Holy Spirit that he began to preach to the Jews. He began to tell the Jews, you crucified him. You killed the prisoner. You killed him. And they got so mad at Stephen, they began to gnash on their teeth. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Y'all can tell when a person gets mad, they know why. I know I'm the first martyr. I know I got to give my life.
Amen.
But he didn't know there was a young man sitting there that had a coat on him. That name was Saul. He didn't know that Saul got convicted and Saul got saved because Stephen's testimony. So be like the first son. You might be, well, Paul is a perfect son. Paul said, I'm going to Damascus. I'm going to kill everybody. I'm going to lock everybody up. But God knocked him down. And when God knocked him down, Paul repented. And Paul said, Lord, what would you have me do? Be like the first son. You might have been rebellious.
Mm-hmm.
You might have been wavering. You might have been prodigal. But you can change.
Mm-hmm.
You can repent. Don't be like the second son who said, yes, I'll do it, but never go and do it. You know, there's a lot of people telling you that. That's why you got to be careful on who your friends are. You got to be careful on who people promise you stuff. Because a lot of people here have let you down. Yes, yes, I don't do anything. As soon as the daddy got out of the house, he ain't going to do nothing. He was self-righteous. Be the one that said, Lord, not my will, but thine be done. As I close, I want to, if you watch my faith, I'd like to share with you the plan of salvation. Always share with everyone that's watching. There's an opportunity for them to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. If you never been born again, here's the sinner's prayer. I pray it every Sunday. You bow your head and say, dear Jesus, I understand what the preacher's saying about me being rebellious, about me being disobedient, wavering, but I realize now that I'm a son. Lord, would you forgive me my sin? Lord, I don't want to go to a devil's hell. I would like to go to heaven. Lord, I believe that Jesus died. I believe that he's buried. And I believe that he rose from the dead. Coming up my whole life, Jesus, today. Come to my Lord Jesus today. If you prayed that prayer, Facebook or anyone, God save you. But don't stop there. James said, don't just be a hearer, but be a doer. Get up and go into a Bible. until next week, Facebook, I'd like to say, look up. Your redemption draweth nigh. In Jesus Christ's name.